All right, what an introduction. Everybody, please welcome Steve Cardenas right here.
Microphone, or do I need it?
You always have a
loud
voice.
Yes, I have.
I want to get to your guys' questions because this panel's for you.
Yeah. We're going to do like a quick 30-minute panel because I got to be taken off to the airport pretty soon, but I still want to be able to have you guys stop by the table one more time if you want before I leave. So this is your chance, opportunity to ask, like, hey, what was it like on the show? What was it like behind the scenes?
Jason David Frank, what was it like working with him?
He's crazy. He was super unpredictable, you know? And sometimes that was very funny and very fun, and sometimes it was rough, you know? just like any, you know, brothers and sisters, you know, any siblings, you know, sometimes you get along, sometimes you don't, you know? But no matter what, we're family, you know? So,
what do you think he would say? What it's like working with Steve Cardenas? What do you think he's like?
I would say the same thing I would, you know? We all got along great. I mean, we were friends, you know, for sure. And to this day, I mean, I still talk to him. You know, I talked to him already 3 times this weekend, so, yeah.
Who pulled the most pranks on set?
That was always Jason. Jason was always the one that was notorious for that. Yeah. Good question, though.
Anybody else got questions? I will ask questions all day long. Power Rangers in my
brain.
So how does one become a Power Ranger? How did you get to be a Power Ranger?
Well, you know what? That was actually pretty unique. Because generally, you know, the casting process takes a very long time. It takes several months, and they do many rounds and rounds and rounds of auditions and things like that. But the original guys that were on the show, they had left the show, and they left in kind of a hurry. So when they left, they were the producers were left, you know, saying we need to find some people really quick. And we've got about 2 weeks to find, you know, a group of people. So they immediately decided to do what's called a cattle call, and that's like a nationwide audition, kind of like American Idol, you know, where they just kind of roll through certain cities and they just let anyone and everyone come down and audition and try out. So that's how it went for me. I was living in Dallas, Texas, so I'm from Texas. And I heard about this audition on the radio, and I decided, well, let me give it a shot. They said, go down to the local TV station and try out, and so on and so forth. So they said, if you know how to do karate or gymnastics or hip-hop dancing, then come show us what you got. And I was like, well, I know how to do gymnastics and martial arts. Hold on, sorry about that. Anyway, and so I went down and I decided to go try out for it and see what would happen. Never dreaming that I'd ever get the part, you know? And so I get there, it's like 5,000 people in the parking lot waiting to try out. I was like, oh, there's no way I'm ever gonna get this part. And to my surprise, a couple days later, they called me back and they said, hey, look, we really liked your audition. We wanna fly you to California and meet the producers and, you know, have you audition against the people that we picked from the other cities and stuff. So they narrowed it down from like, you know, 15 to 20,000 people down to like 12 people. And then they were going to pick 3 from those 12 people. And so when I went to California and auditioned in front of Haim Saban and Should You Let Me Know Them, I was, you know, super nervous and whatnot. But I guess they liked what they saw. And next thing I know, like, hey, congratulations, you're hired. I was like, wow.
I mean, that's got to be.
That was all in a span of like 4 days. You know, I auditioned on a Saturday. Nothing happened on a Sunday. They called me first thing Monday morning. They said, we're going to fly you to California. And that was on, they said, we're gonna fly you on Tuesday. I went and auditioned on Tuesday, but I flew from Dallas to Burbank. And then I auditioned again that same afternoon. And then that same, later on, that very next day, I got hired, so.
I mean, you gotta think, it's Power Rangers, by the time you were auditioning, was already huge.
It was one kid show in the world after being only on for one season.
So trying to land a role for a TV show that's already off the ground, so huge, I mean, that is just, has to be mind-blowing.
Yeah, and the thing too is that I didn't know what my role was gonna be. You know, it's not like they were saying, okay, you're auditioning for the Red Ranger. They just said, we're looking for new Power Rangers. So if you wanna try out and show us what you got, that's it. So I didn't know that I was replacing somebody else. I didn't find that out until after I got hired and I was walking into wardrobe fitting. and they're like, oh, which one are you going to be, the Red or Black Ranger? Like, what do you mean the Red or Black Ranger? And they already have those. They go, no, those guys are gone. So I had no idea what was happening, you know?
So you literally thought you were auditioning for that.
I thought you were adding new people to the cast, yeah. Surreal, actually, because I was familiar with the show. You know, I knew about Power Rangers because I've been teaching martial arts to kids, you know, since I was a kid, you know, and so when the show first came out, all these kids that I was teaching karate to, they're like, oh, I want to be a Power Ranger. And I'm like, what's a Power Ranger? What is that? So I started like watching the show, and I kind of fell in love with it too, you know. I knew all the characters, I was very familiar with the show and everything like that. So I watched it all the time. So being very familiar with it, it was very surreal to when I got hired to walk around to the set and say, oh my gosh, there's the command center. Oh, there's the school. There's the juice bar, you know? So it was very interesting. Yeah, it was very surreal.
So how soon after, so you get the TV show, and I feel like the movie was almost like instantly right after that.
Yeah, it all happened in one sentence. It's just, they said it just like this. Congratulations, you're hired. We have to start filming right away, so you can't go back home to Texas. We're going to put you up in a motel, and we're going to start filming on Monday. You just need to have your parents mail you your clothes, because we don't have the time for you to go back. So we're going to shoot for a month and a half, and then we're shutting production down to go to Australia to do a movie. And that's what they said. That's what they told me when I got hired. All that in one sentence, and I was just shocked. I couldn't believe like how my life had like turned around and all this crazy stuff that was happening to me. Yeah. So, pretty strange. We got this guy over here.
Which was more fun to work on, Zio or Mighty Morphin?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's a really good question. So when I first got hired on the show, I had never done any acting before. Like I said, I just went to one audition that I heard about on the radio. I had no aspirations to be an actor. I didn't even do drama in high school, nothing like that. They hired me solely for my martial arts. And when I got there, they hired an acting coach for me. To kind of like help me with my lines and stuff like that, because that was something that was completely out of my comfort zone. So in the beginning, I was very uncomfortable with the acting side of it, and so with being that it was all on the job training in the beginning, they kind of gave me a lot less to do. You know, they didn't do a lot of focus on my character. But after a couple of years of, you know, doing the movie and doing the TV show for a while, I became more comfortable with myself. And my acting had improved. They started to give my character more to do. So by the time Zio was around, you know, my character had a lot more development, a lot more personality. They gave me a lot more to do. So even though like the Red Ranger suit and Mighty Morphin was my favorite, like, you know, series, Zio was like my favorite season to work on for me personally as an actor and as, you know, for my character. I think they gave me a lot more to do and it was a lot more exciting for me. Yes, ma'am.
I was watching that this morning
on
the TV before we came here.
Okay.
New stuff, I mean.
Oh, the new stuff, okay.
But I was curious to know is when they did the action scenes, and you obviously got the mask on.
Yeah.
And you can hear them talking, but are you actually talking in the mask, or do you do it all before that?
Another very good question, yeah. That's done later in what they call an ADR booth, which stands for Automated Dialogue Replacement. It's voiceover. So a lot of times, the stunt guys would be in the helmets, and then they would be doing all the action and the motions, and they would bob their head like this when it was time to talk, and then we would have to match our voice to the bobbing of their head, you know? So they'd be like, we need Ranger Power now, you know, like that. And so you can't see the mouth move, so we had to like go in and fill that in later, you know? So it was very interesting, and it was very, you know, weird as well too, to kind of learn how to follow along with that. There's another thing that took a long time to learn how to do. Go ahead.
When you say stunt guys, I know originally it was a Japanese show and they'd use the Japanese action scenes and meld in American actors for
the story. Yeah, that's how they did it. But you know, that Japanese footage from the Zoo Ranger series, you know, got used up pretty quick. So by the time I came on the show, you know, they had a full Japanese stunt team called Alpha Stunts that was already in the States, and they were already doing you know, we were filming everything from you know, the only thing that was Japanese footage at that point was just the Zord sequence stuff.
Oh, so those shows diverged pretty quickly?
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, that when that original Japanese footage ran out, we had to recreate everything from scratch.
Well, right? I thought they had seasons continuing on for years.
Well, yeah, I mean, but see, the thing is, you know, in the original Super Sentai series, there was only one season of Zooranger, and that was it. And then the next two, they did, you know, Die Ranger. Then after that, it was a Bow Ranger, which is what we call Zeo. So Bond's idea was to keep the Ranger suits looking the same and stuff, so you could have the consistency. But every year they would change out the Zords and stuff. But after a while, they just ran out of footage, and they had so much of this other Japanese footage that they started saying, "Well, we're gonna start doing new seasons. Like every new season, we're gonna have a new storyline, new costumes." And then they finally said, "We're gonna do all new cast members too." So once a year, they would do, you know, just scrap everything and start from scratch with a whole new series, and then they started labeling it. But they sell more toys that way. So they're a toy machine. They're a toy machine company. Especially at night, make their money on their licensing, you know?
It sounds like, so have you seen the original Japanese?
Yeah, I've seen a bunch of it. And in the beginning, you know, they showed us some of it, but they didn't want to show us too much of it because, you know, the Sentai series was so different than our show. And, you know, they didn't want to really confuse us. You know, they had a direction they wanted to take, and, you know, the Super Sentai series was a lot less wholesome than the Power Rangers series was. So, you know, they didn't want to kind of like, you know, give us like too much of that because they didn't want us to get confused. Yeah.
Have you ever been asked why they followed a different plot line than the Sentai series?
No, I didn't ask. I mean, I couldn't even understand, you know, when they showed us some of that Sentai stuff, I didn't even understand what they were saying or anything like that. You know, it's not like they had it all dubbed for us or anything. So I didn't even know what the plot line was, you know. I just went off the story of what Power Rangers already had. Yes, ma'am.
So did some of the American Power Rangers go to Japan? And were you Greece as well?
No, I've never even been to Japan. I would love to go, but no, I've never even been. So
talking about like all the different costumes and stuff, you said they would kind of change them. Is there a reason why that when the movie came out, the very first Mighty Morphin movie, they decided to do different costumes than what was on the TV show?
Yeah, well, because they knew that, you know, that the movie didn't have to be canon, you know. So they said, well, you know, since it's not really going to have anything to do other than, you know, we're reintroducing new Zords that are going to be reintroduced again in season 3. They knew that they didn't have to have anything match. So they said, well, this is our opportunity to really try this like idea about these really cool armored costumes and things. And they knew they were never going to use those on the show because they're just too expensive and they fall apart too easily and stuff like that. Too hard to maintain. And plus it wouldn't match any of the old Japanese footage either. So they said, well, we're just going to go big budget with the whole thing. Being backed by 20th Century Fox, and they had, you know, like $30 million to play with. So they were like, let's do some really cool command center, let's make some really cool elaborate sets, and, you know, they spent a lot of money on all that stuff to make it look as great as it did. And I think to this day it still holds up, you know?
Oh, easily. Yeah. I prefer more than the new one.
Yeah.
Nice.
They invited me to do it, but I don't know, there was some kind of a scheduling mix-up, and, I guess I couldn't be found at the time that they needed to do it, or I couldn't get, I was in, like, Philadelphia at the time, and I couldn't be there for the filming of it, so I missed out on that one. So, if they ever bring me back, I will definitely come back, so, I don't know, be on the lookout for it, maybe. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I'm curious as to know whether the series is in Japan too, and if it's followed by the Japanese
The series still goes on in Japan, and then every year after the Japanese are finished with their series, they turn all the footage over to Saban, and then Saban creates a whole new Power Rangers series. So we follow a couple years back from the Japanese Sentai series.
Aren't they like three, like two or three seasons?
Two or three seasons ahead, and that's it. Yeah, at the most. Yeah.
Two seasons ahead, right?
Is there two seasons ahead? Yeah, because there were certain ones that we didn't use, you know? Like, they didn't use the Die Rangers as one way back when. And there's the one with all the train zords. We didn't use that one. But yeah, it's that
right. Still
Dino Charger and Ninja Steel now, so, yeah.
He still bought his trains.
Were you given the opportunity to make a cameo in the new movie, like Jason?
No. I wanted to, and I talked to the people at Lionsgate about it, and then they had told me that they weren't doing any cameos. And so that's what they had told me at first, but I put my name in like really, really early. So I think at first they were gonna do cameos, and then they said, well, we need to do cameos, but they decided, let's pick the two most popular ones, and that's kind of what they were. So, I was like, you could have brought the other four in, but
maybe another sequel, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe a sequel.
Maybe.
What do you think of the new Batman movie?
I liked it. Obviously, Power Rangers is all about, you know, this diverse group of people learning how to work together, right? And so, that side of the story, I think they nailed, you know? I think they got that part right. But the only thing I wish they probably would have done is like started the action a little bit sooner, you know what I mean? Because Power Rangers is not just about the teamwork, but it's also about kicking butt. And we didn't get to see a lot of that till the very end, and then I think they should have made that happen a little bit faster.
Yeah, you almost forgot you were watching a Power Rangers movie for a minute, because it was like, okay, when do we see the Rangers? Okay, when do we see those costumes?
And they need to make that more faster.
Right.
And again, that part was great. All of that was great, but I feel like they could have definitely started that a lot sooner. You know?
They definitely took the teenagers with attitude comment very seriously.
Yeah. Go ahead, bud.
Who was your favorite villain to fight against?
Well, actually, my favorite is Lord Zedd. I mean, he's, you know, because he just looks so cool, you know? And in the beginning, it was really kind of, you know, really scary, you know? But, like, he was scaring the kids too much, so they started getting some... too many letters, you know, saying this Lord Zedd's a little too scary, so they decided to kind of goof him up a little bit, and they did the whole Rita and Zedd wedding thing, you know, kind of put a little bit more of a human side to them a little bit, you know, so they weren't as scary, but in early Lord Zedd was kind of like my favorite, and, you know, of course, I lose because he was just so great, you know, he said that Paul Freeman is such a great actor, too.
Oh yeah, I would say Ivan Ooze was definitely, like, he still had the very menacing thing to him, but he had those one-liners that would just give you every single time.
He could not stop laughing whenever he came on.
Yeah.
Was there laughing in the movie, like,
Sure.
You guys find yourself laughing?
Yeah, we were laughing on set all the time, for sure.
Did you ever get covered in that purple ooze?
No, luckily I never got slime as it is, or oozed.
So do you have any, of the props or anything from TV show, movies?
I have some stuff. Somehow I acquired them.
Didn't they throw away a lot of stuff?
Yeah, they did. They threw away a lot of stuff. Actually, they threw a bunch of stuff into warehouses. There's a bunch of warehouses all over Burbank and stuff where stuff is just sitting there. And when it got sold to Disney put it in a different warehouse, and then with Saban buying it back, nobody can find anything anymore. It's just all lost.
Been lost
weird in a warehouse somewhere in the valley.
Somebody find it 50 years
from now. Somebody's going to clear out an old storage, you know, warehouse or one of those storage warehouses, and then come across a whole treasure of, you know, really cool stuff. But yeah.
Do you think that they would ever do a movie with the new Rangers from the new movie combining with the old Rangers somehow renaming their powers for a short time?
You'll just have to wait and see.
How do you feel about Bulk and Skull?
I love them, and you know, I mean, I thought they were always funny, and they were the ones that had us laughing the most on set. You know, I mean, like, they had after every real cut, like the whole crew, even all the crew, the lighting people, everybody, you know, they would all be cracking up because these guys were so funny. Their comedic timing was like so good, and they were like always on point, you know. And a lot of it was ad lib stuff. You know, they just come in and just make up stuff as it goes along. So they were very smart, very classically trained too. As a matter of fact, remember I told you when I got hired, they hired an acting coach for me. Well, my acting coach was Paul Schreier, like the guy who played Polo. He was the guy that was like, okay, so this is your what you need to do. And yeah, so he was my guy. It was all because of him. You know, I give him a lot of credit for helping be look better on camera. You know?
Was there ever any talk of like maybe Baldwin Skull becoming a power into for an episode?
No.
I think they probably tried to do that in the comics a little bit, but they didn't do that in the show. I remember, I think it was probably like season 3, I think, that Bulk and Skull were like on the mission to try to find out who the Power Rangers were, you know? And then I always come close to maybe figuring it out, but never quite.
Anybody else have any questions? We have just a little bit of time left.
It would be disaster if Bulk and Skull ever became Rangers. It'd be disaster.
I think something important that we gotta know is that you get the Power Rangers job, you know, and then a couple months down the road, you walk down a toy aisle and start seeing your face on things. Like, how
awkward was it?
Well, there was nothing awkward about it. I thought it was pretty effing cool, you know? Not gonna lie, you know? I mean, I remember the first day I got on set. This photographer came up and was like, okay, I need you to hold it still. I gotta take pictures of the 360 of your head. And I'm like, why? I said, oh, because we need it so we can make a 3D, you know, head of your face for the toys. That's awesome, man. So cool. And now I'm forever like part of pop culture now because of that, you know, I got a toy with my face on it.
Even now they still like when they talk about anniversaries.
And they're really rare now too. There are a couple of like those flip top head ones, you know, with the Red Ranger ones, sort of like
the Morphin ones.
The Morphin ones. Yeah, the Rocky ones are expensive now, like $250 for one of those things now because they're so hard to find.
Were you ever in a store and like you see a figure and like you turn to someone and be like,
no, I never did that, you know, because it was like, you know, when we were filming, we were on the show, you know, we'd be filming like 12 hours a day, you know, it's 12, 13 hours a day, and then it's like, you know what, that's it, I'm home, I'm going to bed, I gotta go get up at 5:00 in the morning. So, you know, we didn't have a lot of interaction with our fans in any way at that time. Plus, they were all pretty little, and then there was no way for them to communicate with us other than fan mail. And they would send regular snail mail to us. You know, that's how we would, you know, get some fan letters and things like that. But there was no social media. There was none of that stuff. So there was no way to connect with the fans. Plus, they were really little. So if we ever did meet any fans, they were usually just pretty shy and kind of like hide behind their mom and stuff, you know?
Did you have any mall tours?
We did. That was the only time that we had like a big connection with the fans. But even then, you know, there was a disconnect because there'd be a barrier between us and there would be a big crowd of people. And, you know, we'd kind of like wave and we could sign a few autographs when we could. And then, you know, we'd off on to the next little thing. But, you know, so there was really no interaction like we do now with the conventions, you know, Comic-Con. You really can sit down one-on-one and we can talk and I get to hear all kinds of great stories about how, you know, somehow I inspired somebody to be, you know, a martial artist or, you know, or got me through a rough time in my childhood, whatever, that kind of story, you know. And for me, that's great, you know. I'm really glad that I was able to be a part of that, you know. I'm forever blessed by that.
Yeah. Anyway,
go ahead.
What's the coolest piece of memorabilia from the show that you've ever signed, that anybody's ever brought to you?
You know, like when we do Power Morphicon, which is the big Power Ranger convention they do every other year, which is going to be happening in 2018 in Anaheim. If you guys get the chance, you should go, because it's amazing. I mean, every Power Ranger from like every season is going to be there, all the villains, all the voices of all the bad guys are all going to be there. It's incredible. Man, sometimes also people, not only to, you know, all the voices and stuff, but all the people that were behind the scenes are there at the Power Morphicon too. All the stunt coordinators, the prop guy, and the prop guy always has all kinds of real props from the show for sale when you go there.
Oh, wow.
And he's got amazing stuff, you know?
Didn't they start bringing over some of the Japanese actors too to the Power Morphicon?
Uh-huh, yeah, they have some of the Japanese Sentai guys are there too. So I have a picture of me, Austin St. John, and
I think I've seen that.
So there's all three of us in the Red Ranger from Ranger. Yeah. So the three original Tyranno guys who were the only ones who ever wore the red diamond suit.
Yeah. Very cool. Back though, when they did the Ten Sabers, the Angels
entry. I don't know. I don't remember that.
It was
got me on that one too.
Yeah. It was
question? Oh no, he's coming closer.
Right on. Did anybody else have any questions before Steve takes off? You're gonna be back at your booth.
Yeah, I'm gonna go back to my booth for a little bit, guys. So if you guys have more questions, you're welcome to come on over there. I got some autographs available. All my other memorabilia is sold out already. I have coins and Megazords and Pops and all kinds of stuff like that, but I already sold out. But I still got 8x10s available, things like that. If you guys wanna come over there and hang out, because I gotta take off probably in about 30 to 45 minutes. So I wanted to give you guys one more chance to come back over to the table if you want. So yeah, go ahead, last question.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've gone to his school several times and taught seminars for his kids and everything. Yeah, absolutely.
So I want to thank you, Steve Cardenas, very
thank
much.
Thank you.
I've had the pleasure of moderating you twice now. So he's a great guy. Everybody, please give Steve Cardenas.
Thank you, guys. Thank you guys for all the support for some ideas and followers. Thank you.
I'll see you all later.
You have the helmet there too, right?
Yeah, sure.
Sure.
I don't know, there was a lot. I think probably